1/3 of the Gospels is devoted to the last few days of Jesus' life on earth. For evangelists, the death and resurrection of Jesus is clearly the most significant event of his life. So, why did Jesus have to die on the cross? And what difference does it make for me? Today on Cross Connection, we will take a closer look at the crucifixion of Jesus the Messiah. Welcome to an interactive and live study of the Word of God and life and teachings of Jesus. Cross Connection is about us studying together. And we really enjoy when you leave your comments on our Facebook page and let us know how Cross Connection affected your life. You can always write to us at crossconnection@hopetv.org. Or you can join our discussion right now by simply picking up the phone and sending us a text. Send your text anytime during our discussion to 70707-210-75. And don't forget that you can join our ongoing conversation on Facebook anytime, anywhere in the world. We want to connect with you. Sergio, we were enjoying the comments and the questions of our viewers, didn't we?
Yeah, you know, it's amazing what happens when you take this little piece of text and then you have perspectives from all kinds of people from all over and how it brings it to life in this new way. And it's amazing how, you know, you get all these different perspectives and you see it in a way that you wouldn't have seen it before. And we just want to tell everyone that has sent in a comment how thankful we are, how appreciative we are, and how blessed we've been by it. And whether you've sent in a comment or not, we invite you to join in our conversation today. And today we're going to be talking about the cross. And you see the cross all over the place. You see it on big tabernacles and cathedrals. You see it hanging around necks, tattooed on arms, pierced into ears, stuck onto people's cars. But what does the cross mean? We see it as a symbol of Jesus' love and sacrifice, sure. But did anything actually happen on the cross? Today, as we go over the events of Jesus' death, we want to discuss this question with you. What did Jesus' death on the cross accomplish? Looking forward to your comments.
You know, Sergio, this question sounds very familiar to us, but we will find out what you have to think about. So write us. We'll definitely wait for your responses. The cover of the April 8, 1966 edition of Time magazine asked the question, "Is God dead?" At the time, a movement called Death of God was arising in American theology. The idea of the death of God, however, was popularized by Friedrich Nietzsche in his Die fröhliche Wissenschaft, or the gay science. Listen to how Nietzsche describes the death of God. "Have you not heard of that madman who lit a lantern in the bright morning hours, ran to the marketplace and cried incessantly, 'I see God, I seek God!'? As many of those who did not believe in God were standing around just then, he provoked much laughter and 'Has he got lost?' asked one. 'Did he lose his way like a child?' asked another. 'Or is he hiding? Is he afraid of us? Has he gone on a voyage? Maybe he immigrated?' They yelled and laughed. The madman jumped into their midst and pierced them with his eyes. 'Where is God?' he cried. 'I will tell you, we have killed him, you and I. All of us are his murderers. But how did we do this? How could we drink up the sea? Who gave us the sponge to wipe away the entire horizon? What were we doing with the unchained, to unchain this earth from its sun? Where is it moving now? Where are we moving? Away from all suns? Are we not plunging continually? Backward, sideward, forward, in all directions. Is there still any up and down? Are we not straying as through an infinite nothing? Do we not feel the breath of empty space? Has it not become colder? Is not night continually closing in on us? Do we not need to light lanterns in the morning? Do we hear nothing as yet of the noise of the graveyards who are burying God? Do we smell nothing as yet of the divine decomposition? God's to decompose. God is dead. God remains dead. And we have killed him. These were the words of Friedrich Nietzsche. And today on Cross Connection, we will take a closer look at perhaps the most significant event in the history of the world. This event has changed the world completely. We will talk about the crucifixion of Jesus, the Messiah, Jesus, the Son of God. And I am glad because we are joined today by Jitesh, Jennifer, and we will be discussing this, the most significant event in the history of Christianity, perhaps. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Some people call it the crucifixion of God himself. And we will find out why. But before we jump into our discussion and our study, I would like to ask you a question about to elaborate on the quote that I just read, the quote of Friedrich Nietzsche. Who was Friedrich Nietzsche, if Sergio can just remind us?
He's the father of nihilism.
Yeah, so could you just elaborate it a little bit more on the word nihilism? Yeah.
Nihilism is kind of a rejection of everything, belief in nothing.
Okay, so he was basically believing in nothing.
That's my super, super dumbed down answer. Yeah.
Okay, so he didn't even, and obviously he did not believe in God.
Right.
And he proclaimed, he was the one who popularized this idea of God is dead. Mm-hmm. And some people took it seriously and subscribed to this idea. Mm-hmm. So how would you respond to his claim?
I was moved by the wording of it, how grand it all seemed, the tragedy of the words that he used. Mm-hmm. Have we drunk up the sea and all of these things of something that is seemingly impossible to do, we have done, how have we done it, where does it leave us? That's moving language for me.
Yeah.
I think that's
a really sort of a hard question, because I think often people ask, you know, when bad things happen, where is God? You know, is God absent? Does God care? And I know that was a really sort of hard question for people to ask during certain periods of history, like the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. Another writer, Eli Weisel, I think I'm saying it correctly, asked that same question, where is God? And then he answered that question, you know, when I'm suffering, God is with me. He's in the same place when I'm suffering that he was when his son was on the cross. You know, he's there with me through all of these terrible things that are happening. And, you know, we're going to get to a part in the story today where we're going to see that there is a better ending than the one that was talked about.
This is beautiful. And I think it sums up the entire, it is a beautiful answer to this entire quote. Thank you, Jennifer. Sure. Okay, and let's start with the prayer. And Jennifer, if you could lead us in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us the opportunity to answer this question about where are you in the middle of life struggles. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit to be with us to guide our discussion. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Mm. Okay, so the most dramatic event in the life of Christianity and Christians in general. You know, in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23, we can read about this passage, about Paul describing how difficult it is to preach about Jesus who was crucified. For Jews, it is a stumbling block. Mm. For Greeks, it is foolishness. Mm-hmm. How and why do I have to preach about God who was crucified, who suffered this foolish death on the cross, it seems like. But by the power of God, this message transformed billions of lives. Mm. And by the power of God, our lives today will be transformed. And by the power of God, your life today will be transformed as well. So join our discussion and
let's
get
started.
Yeah,
let's do it.
Let's make sure that our lives are transformed.
Absolutely.
Okay, so and today I would like us to take a different approach to this story, because this story has been told and told many times.
Yeah, very familiar.
Very familiar story, yes. And I would like to encourage you to read at home this entire chapter, Matthew chapter 27. Read the entire gospel according to Matthew, but especially this chapter 27. It is very important for us to understand the suffering of God himself.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, and why I'm telling you that we will take a different approach, because we will compare all characters that play significant role in this chapter, and we will start with two first characters. And who is the first character who we see in Matthew chapter 27?
Judas.
Judas, correct. But before Matthew chapter 27, we see another character, his name is?
Peter.
Peter.
Yep.
So let's compare Judas and Peter because they have a lot in common and a lot in, right. in different. Okay, and who would like? Jitesh, yeah.
Well, with Peter and Judas, they both are disciples of Jesus. And I guess I'll just get to the main part of it, but Peter denied Jesus and Judas betrayed Jesus. And we had discussed this, you know, a little earlier, and for me, it's, you know, what's the difference between the two? If one denied and one betrayed, but both gave up Jesus' name, or you know, in, it's both the same thing to me. So, how do let's get into that part because I'm actually asking a question.
Okay, this is cool. Thanks, Judas.
There we go.
So, so what we see? Yeah, we see Peter. We see Judas.
Right.
Peter, in our eyes, he's a good man. He was always with Jesus. He was always, and he, even though he denied Jesus, but ultimately he's a good man. Judas, we always see him as a bad man.
Right.
Yeah.
Even though he was also a disciple of Jesus, but he had, I mean, he also betrayed Jesus, which is just as Peter. But there is something important.
But also, I think maybe one more similarity that would add to what Jitesh said. Peter and Judas still saw Jesus' purpose as setting up a Jewish nation. And so when, you know, Jesus was about to be betrayed, Peter was ready to fight. He never really accepted that Jesus was going to go on the cross. He was, and I think that's why he denied Jesus, because he was sort of thinking the same thing that Judas was thinking.
But yeah, Jitesh.
But that's the part that I kind of argue with myself is, is it better to be like Peter and to fight, and then when it comes down to it, you still deny him anyways?
This is very important because the conclusion of the story, of both stories, is extremely important.
Yeah.
Okay.
Judas, he had remorse. Peter repented.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And let's read one verse, which is chapter 26, last verse, actually the last few lines before the rooster crowd. Sergio, if you could read for us.
Sure.
Where
am I starting?
Verse 74.
Okay.
Chapter 26.
Then he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly.
So this is this is the repentance of Peter.
Right.
Yeah.
And let's read about the remorse of Judas now. And Jitesh, if you could read chapter 27. Verses 3 and 4.
Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood."
Okay, so do you see something different here?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if this is what you're looking for, but what stands out to me is, they both feel bad for what they did. We can debate who who did what that was worse, probably Judas. But how they handle it is he gives the money back to the people that he got it from. That's who he goes to make it right with.
Yes.
He goes back to those people that he got the money from. And when he references Jesus, he says, he doesn't say, "I have betrayed God's son. I haven't betrayed the Christ. Maybe he doesn't think much of this guy, but he is willing to admit that this guy was innocent. And but that's as far as he's willing to go, and he just feels bad about that, but it's not.
But there is a key, actually, in this verse. Yeah, go ahead.
But I mean, but still, I think we have to go a little bit further, because I think it doesn't even, it's not even super clear just by reading this text, but I think it's the fact that Judas committed suicide. I mean, he didn't see a Savior who would forgive him.
Yes.
Exactly, exactly.
Yes. Yeah. And this is something which is very important as well. But again, just there is a key word in this verse, verse 3. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been what?
Condemned.
Condemned.
Yeah.
He was condemned by others because he was betraying the son of, I mean, not the son, but at least his teacher. So he was condemned by others. That is why his remorse, okay, give here is your money. I will just go ahead and just hand myself because I cannot live with this burden.
Right.
Peter says, no.
Well, it wasn't the condemnation of Judas, it was the condemnation of Jesus, right? Because it's capital, he, when Judas, Jesus's betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned.
Yes, you're right.
Was remorseful.
Okay. Yes, when Jesus had been condemned. Yeah, you're right. You're right. Thank you so much for pointing that out. Yes. So basically, what we see. Started from scratch.
Sure.
When we talk about the repentance and remorse, mm-hmm. is it important for us to understand what is happening in our lives?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Why?
Because, I mean, as I was looking at all of these different, like, perspectives on the crucifixion, I was thinking at any given time, I could be any one of these people. I mean, I have all of these mm-hmm. tendencies, mm-hmm. you know, and it's only by the grace of God I don't end up in the same place that Judas found himself.
So if I experience remorse because I've done something wrong, because it hurts me now, because it's painful, because, or some people say, you know, you've done something wrong, look at you, like,
right.
I experience remorse, I act like Judas.
Right. Mm.
But if I fall down on my knees and I say, Lord, I'm so sorry, I love you mm-hmm. to my death.
Yeah.
And I'm so sorry that I betrayed you because I didn't want to.
Yeah.
This is repentance. Let's learn how to repent. Okay. Unfortunately, we need to take this break. Why the breaks are... we need to, yeah. As we take this break, maybe it's a perfect time for us to think about today's question then and share your thoughts with us. What did Jesus' death on the cross accomplish? Send us your text anytime during the discussion to 707-200-1075. Or you can join our discussion on Facebook anytime. Welcome back to Cross Connection. Don't keep your discussion to yourself. Just join our discussion because we need to...
Stop talking in your own head.
Exactly. Just talk with us. Don't keep your comments to yourself. Because we want to hear what people
Absolutely.
Have to say.
Totally.
Okay, so let's compare and see the contrast between two other people.
Okay.
This is amazing now. Okay, it gets really amazing. Because we will compare now Jesus, not really compare, but... We will talk about Barabbas mm-hmm. or Jesus Barabbas.
Right.
And Jesus the Christ.
Right. Mm.
Jesus the Christ. And we will see why and how. And I will reveal one little interesting detail that people usually overlook, and I overlook as well sometimes when I read it. And Jennifer, if you could tell us the story of Jesus Barabbas and what was happening there, Jesus the Christ.
So
where was it and what
sure.
was happening?
So Pilate the governor didn't really want to do anything to Jesus because he knew he was innocent. And so he was looking for a way out of his situation. So mm-hmm. he said, I'm going to offer this mob of people who he was really concerned about controlling because he didn't want it to get back to Rome that he couldn't control the people and lose his position. And so he said, you know, I'm going to sort of offer them an alternative. I will say, you know, I'll release Barabbas, who is this insurrectionist who's really trying to take down Rome, mm-hmm. or I'll release Jesus, and surely they're going to pick Jesus. I mean, mm-hmm. Jesus has been healing, like, mm-hmm. all of the people and teaching, and he's so nice. Everybody will want to pick Jesus. And then I'll be free of this situation. Mm-hmm. But what happened, the high priest and the other religious leaders mm-hmm. had already been talking to the people, and they told them to pick Barabbas.
Yes.
And so instead of picking Jesus, who was the savior of the world, they picked Barabbas, who was someone more in line with what they were really wanting, which was establishing a Jewish nation.
Wow, this is a very, like, this is something that has not been anticipated.
Mm.
Yeah. It's like, no way, it's not going to happen. If you read the gospel for the first time, mm-hmm. if you read this passage, which is Matthew 27 verses 15 all the way, you would think, of course, like, if I didn't know the story, I would think, of course, they would pick Jesus, they would
right.
choose Jesus. Oh. But the outcome is like, wow.
Yeah.
That is so profound because I think that's what we do today. I mean, how often do we pick, you know, earthly security, earthly whatever, earthly regard over the things of God?
You're saying mm. the truth, but let me tell you something very unique. Because in New King James Version, it's in verse 16. And Jitesh, I would like you to read verse 16 in New King James Version.
And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas.
So what was the name of the prisoner?
Barabbas.
Okay, let's read New International Version, verse 16. And Sergio, you have New International
yes,
Version.
Yes, sir. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Jesus Barabbas.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
So, wow. It's like if you read another translation and many other translations, they would say Jesus Barabbas. Mm. Because the earlier manuscripts, they had the same word, Jesus Barabbas. But maybe, we don't know for sure, but maybe later scribes, they just decided to erase Jesus because it was too confusing. Too confusing. So now we talk about two people, Jesus Barabbas.
Yeah.
And Jesus, the Christ, because we read the following verse 17. If you, Jennifer, if you could read for us verse 17.
Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas
or Jesus Barabbas? Or Jesus Barabbas or?"
Or Jesus who is called Christ.
Yeah. So here is Jesus Barabbas and Jesus the Christ.
Yeah.
Wow.
But it's not the end. Barabbas, the very word Barabbas means the son of the father.
Wow.
Bar, Abbas, the son, Abba, father, the son of the father.
Sure.
But the name, so Jesus, the son of the father. Uh-huh. And here is another Jesus. Jesus, the son of?
The father.
God.
Of God.
But another father, of God.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing.
So here's two Jesuses. And Jesus, the very word Jesus, means Yahweh saves, or Jehovah saves, Yahweh saves.
Right.
Yahweh saves the son of the father, Yahweh saves the son of God. And who people choose?
Man. Son of the father.
The son of the other father.
Yeah. The son of earthly father. What do we have to do with this divine?
Yeah.
Wow.
And this is what, Jennifer, you were talking about.
Yeah.
Just now.
Amazing. It's unbelievable. I mean, because you have this whole Bible and this whole story of redemption leading up to this chapter in Matthew, and people are still, in spite of everything that God has done, choosing this earthly kingdom.
But at the same time, there is a great hope.
Yes.
Because there is a great hope. Because if this Jesus save us, Yahweh saves, or Yahweh saves the son of the father, who am I? Who am I? I'm the son of the Father. I'm not divine. And I am being saved by the other son who takes all my sins and takes my place on that cross.
So you can almost see more and more as you dig into it how it was set up from the beginning. That Jesus knew that these things had to happen according. Because if it was anybody else, the word play, it could have been a whole different outcome.
This is just amazing. It's all just amazing.
Like, I never knew that. So just to see that, it's like that's incredible. It's like
praise God. Yeah. The only thing we can say, praise God. Okay, let's talk about two more characters. We need to go ahead. Mm-hmm. Sergio, who are those two other characters that we see right immediately after that? One is Pilate.
Pilate and Pilate's wife.
Exactly. Yeah. Pilate's wife is not usually talked about.
Yeah.
But today we will do it. So Pilate's wife will be remembered. So it's just two verses actually.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I had always had like a soft spot in my heart for Pilate. You know, I'd always thought he saw Jesus was innocent. He tried to get his way out of it, you know, and he did what he could, and I had always felt, maybe not that he got a bad rap, but I kind of felt for the guy. But reading it again, I'm like, you know, the more when you're confronted with something, I mean, you're the ultimate good. Jesus is the ultimate good incarnate. Mm-hmm. You have to do more than a lazy attempt at, you know, vindicating yourself to try to get the guy out of it. You need to really make a stand, and that's what he was unwilling to do. He really had to make a stand, and he ultimately failed to do that. And what's amazing is, for all these characters, you see God, all these people that are involved in the death of Jesus, all of them except for really the Pharisees and these people who we heard earlier in Matthew had committed the unpardonable sin. They had cut themselves off from the Holy Spirit completely. All the other characters, they're given a chance. They're given an out. Every single one of them, they have their chance. Judas has his chance to repent, but he ends his own life. Mm-hmm. Pilate has his... God gives a dream to his wife.
Wow.
Yeah. You know?
Like,
wow.
I mean, how much you don't have to do this. God is literally speaking to him through someone he should trust, you know, through he'll know.
Yeah.
Not just some shaman shows up, it's his wife.
Yes.
The way Sergio felt is exactly the way I felt, is that I've had that soft spot for Pilate. Mm. But now reading the part where he said, where he washed his hands and said, "I am, you know, clean of this man's blood," or whatever he said, you know.
Right.
that just made me just, I lost all respect for
right,
the man. Because
right.
what he did is the same thing that Judas did by throwing the silver back. It's like, here, take the silver back.
Right.
I didn't do
it. I want
this.
no part of this.
Yeah, yeah. I take it back. I didn't do it. Mm. But
and you're right, gentlemen, the two of you. And I agree with you. I mean, because sometimes we think, okay, he was a Gentile, so maybe he was just a little bit softer than all those Jews. No.
Yeah.
All were against Jesus and all were given a chance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All were against, and but it, all were given.
It's one of those things, if you're not for me, you're against me. And they,
yeah.
and they weren't willing to be for him.
Exactly.
So what happened? They played a role in being against him.
Mm-hmm. But the other part of it, I think, is that you just see all of these different ways that we can be tempted. I think in all these characters, there is a little bit of a different twist.
Yeah.
So for Pilate, it was maintaining, you know, face and power and not being undermined by, you know, the people that he was supposedly governing. But I think if we look at our own lives, we can see parallel temptations that we may face.
That's very true.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. And I'm sure that people all around the globe, they're just, they have their comments, and the comments are flooding in our Facebook page as well. So please join our discussion. And Sergio, do you have any comments today?
Yeah, before we have to toss to one of your hated breaks,
yes.
I just want to jump in with a few comments. People are sending in different angles on what did the cross mean? What's it have to do? So Nadine says it's a fulfillment of prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
It was a fulfilling of prophecy that was accomplished. Topeka says salvation for us. Eunice says salvation for all. And I'll just do one more. We have quite a few more. I'll just read one more. Shadrach says the cross completed the mission that Jesus had on earth.
Beautiful. Man. All those comments are excellent. And please be a part of our discussion, because we want your contribution and we want to hear what you have
Absolutely.
To say about this
Absolutely.
Question.
Yeah.
And your question will be read, and don't forget to text us as well. So your share your thoughts about today's question. What did Jesus' death on the cross accomplish? We are looking forward to our to your comments and our comments as well after this break. Let us know what you think, and your comment will be read here in the studio by Sergio.
Wow.
You can post your thoughts on Facebook or by texting to 707-200-1075. Welcome back. The study of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire. Yes?
That's right. Fire alarm is going to go off.
And if you feel the same, don't keep it to yourself.
Absolutely.
So this is amazing, because maybe people would say, okay, why do they approach this story with smiles?
Mm,
and I'll tell you why. Because in this story, there is a lot of tears.
Mm.
But in this story, there is a lot of praise.
Amen.
Amen.
And if you want to know why we are smiling now, watch our program next week, because you will find out why.
Read chapter 28. Yeah.
And read chapter 28. And read chapter 27 as well, because these chapters, they're just, they have power in themselves.
Mm.
Because in these chapters, we see God himself doing something absolutely amazing. Let's continue. So another character that we talk about, and another characters, it's the soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
And in contrast with Simon the Cyrene.
Mm-hmm.
And we will find out who those soldiers are and who is that Simon, the Cyrene. And Jitesh, if you could
touch on the soldiers.
Okay.
These were the soldiers that that mocked Jesus. So they took him into the praetorium.
Mm-hmm.
And what is a praetorium? Do you know the actual, like,
okay, good. This is an excellent question. Tell us the story and I will tell you what praetorium is.
All right. So he takes them into the praetorium.
Yes.
Jesus into the praetorium, and he said he was the king of the Jews, they put garments on him, very expensive clothing, you know, to make him look like a king.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it was time to put the crown, they put a crown of thorns.
Mm-hmm.
And they, you know, stuck it into his head.
Yeah, and then gave him the reed.
Yes, wow. The reed.
And then they said, okay, hail the king of the Jews, and they spit on him.
Yeah. Yes.
And then what did they do then? They led him out.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh yeah, and then they removed the clothing off of him.
Yes.
Put regular clothing, or not so great clothing.
It's a grotesque scene.
And they beat him.
You know,
and they beat him.
It's really grotesque. They're enjoying it.
It's
you know, you see the sick, sadistic side of
yes.
of the culture that produced something as awful as crucifixion. But they're enjoying this. They're getting fun out of it.
You're right. It's very grotesque. And bear in mind that if you are a reader and if you don't know the entire story, just start to read. Start reading verse 27 without even knowing what is happening, without even preceding scene. Mm-hmm. You would see that the soldiers lead this king in the Praetorium. Praetorium, this is a very important question, Agitation. I'm thankful to you for this question. Mm-hmm. Praetorium is actually the place where the king's palace.
Mm. Wow.
So they led him, in other words, in the king's palace.
Wow. Mm.
So it was the procedure was exactly the procedure how the king was supposed to be crowned.
Like a total mockery. Yeah.
It was exactly the same how the king is crowned, grotesque.
Know, I just want to jump in because when you point out these little features, you know when you're watching a movie and there's some seemingly random detail, you know, someone mentions a clock randomly that has nothing to do with the plot, you think, oh, okay, that clock's going to factor in later on. They would never just mention it for no reason. It's the same thing when you read the Gospels here. You see some seemingly random Praetorium, okay, skip by it. But why would he mention the Praetorium? And whenever I ask you or someone else asks you a question, hey, what's the deal with this? You always have some profound answer for the meaning behind it.
But this is amazing now, because if you read this story in those terms, now think about... For those soldiers, they're just mocking another rival or another revolutionary. Yeah. But for us readers, we know that we're reading the story of King.
The son of God.
The son of God, the king, he is the king. He, even though they mock him, even though they spit on him, he is the one who will be crowned.
Yeah.
And even though his throne will be what? What is going to be his throne?
Cross.
The cross.
Yeah.
Wow.
Despite that, he's our king.
You know, like I'm just going to jump in. We're getting a lot of comments. So I'm going to jump in with a comment from, we don't have a name. If you send in a text, you know, try and attach a name so we can thank you, you know, rather than thanking anonymous. But we have a text here that says, Jesus is creator and Lord. He became creature and servant. He who was God was made man in flesh. Jesus paid the death penalty for our sins. This makes forgiveness and eternal life possible for those who by faith accept his blood. Amen. Jesus also is the merciful and faithful high priest who makes reconciliation for our sins. Jesus came to restore in man the image of God.
Yeah, this is beautiful.
Yeah, thank
you
for that.
The thing that really sticks out here to me is that, you know, salvation is free, but it's not cheap. Jesus, you know, God paid like this huge price, and who would have ever thought that such a small rebellion would culminate in the creation, killing the creator.
But the more you read into it, it's, I mean, just now learning what Praetorium means, I mean, that amplifies the pain in my heart times 100. It's this man is going through the worst mockery that anyone in this world probably has ever experienced.
Absolutely.
And he's the one who created it all. I feel horrible just thinking about it. Like, really, it's very painful for what
terrible.
He went
through.
Yeah, and it just reminds me of another story in the book of Judges. It says in the end of the book of Judges, and there was no king in Jerusalem, and they did whatever they wanted to do. And here is the king. Here is the king, and the only answer is there is no king, because they don't want this king to be their king, and that is why they do whatever they want to do.
I just want to jump on what Jethesh said, because we know the story so well, but whenever you revisit it, it's just so mind-blowing to think the creator comes to save his creations, and in order to do so, he needs to be eaten alive by them. They just utterly devour him and tear him up to part, and that's actually part of his plan to save us. It's just like mind-blowing.
Death would have almost been better initially, just to kill him, but that wasn't enough. That just had to be when he just had nothing left in him for him to be.
But we need to remember the most important grand battle that is happening between God and the one who is the schemer of this world, the one who is constantly against God.
Right.
And he knew what was going to happen.
Yes.
And that is why it is crucially important, because now we need to find out. I mean, let me just ask you one more question, the one that you know the answer immediately. What was the place where Jesus actually died?
Golgotha.
And if we read Golgotha in verse 33, actually, and Sergio, could you read for us this verse, please?
Absolutely.
Verse 33.
They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull.
So, Golgotha, which is the place of the skull. Bear this in mind, and let's go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And Sergio knows why we go there, because
this is awesome. Yeah.
Because we talked about it before, yeah. Sergio. Yeah, 3:15, Genesis 3:15. And Sergio, if you could, and or whoever finds it, yeah.
You have it?
I didn't.
Oh, well, I've got 3:15, it.
3:15,
okay.
Yes.
And I will put enmity. And this is, I guess, to put perspective, this is God talking to the woman.
To the serpent. To the serpent. Yeah. So this is God talking to the serpent, who is Satan.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel.
So who will crush his head?
The offspring.
The offspring, yeah, the seed.
Yeah.
His head. And you will bruise his heel only.
Yeah.
So, what is the name of the place where Jesus died?
And
place of the skull.
Place of the skull, or the place of the dead head.
Wow.
Where was the serpent crushed into his head?
The place of the skull.
That is
on the cross.
The thing that's so amazing now to me when I was thinking about this is that, you know, Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him way back in Genesis, still decided to go through with it. You know, people are prepared to do a lot of things that they don't really have a lot of knowledge about what it entails. Mm. So you could say, oh, I'd give my life for this person. But if you had to know blow by blow that all of this was going to happen to you, I think that is a very difficult decision to make. And many people would be like, you know, I'm so sorry. I can't.
Even Jesus agonized over it in Gethsemane. Yeah.
But I think,
please.
I thought this was important, but the point is, in order to go through something so horrible, as you were saying, Jennifer, is you obviously have to love these people more than love itself. It's like another word for love.
Yeah.
In order to go
There is no word that explains this kind of love.
And since we're on that, I'll jump in with another comment. And also want to thank Kevin, because Kevin gave his name in the text.
Thanks, Kevin.
So thank you, Kevin. It says, I think Christ's death on the cross accomplished so many things. Salvation for us all, and it showed a watching universe the awesome love of its creator.
Amen.
And the lengths he would go to save his creation.
That's wow. Amen.
Thanks, Kevin.
I like
Amen.
That one.
Yeah.
Wow, this is truly awesome. And finally, like on that cross, when Jesus was on that cross, there was this plague, or this inscription that was put...
Mm-hmm. Plaque.
Plaque. Yeah, right. That was put on his cross, the inscription. What did the inscription say?
King of the Jews.
King of the Jews, right?
Or this is Jesus.
There you go.
The King of the Jews. This is Yahweh saves the King of the Jews.
Yeah.
And we know that was truly the King of the, not the, just the Jews, but the universe.
And we were just talking, too, about crushing the head of the serpent. And we have another text here that is in line with that. It says, what Jesus Christ accomplished on the cross is he tore the veil. He canceled all of Satan's work on humankind.
Yes.
Amen.
And he united. He united all the universe.
Yeah.
Amen.
Okay, we need to continue, and we enjoy your comments. So please continue sending in all those comments, because they enhance our discussion.
Absolutely. Yeah, join our conversation.
Yeah. And join. Yeah, absolutely. You see, even Jennifer wants you to join our
conversation. Join our
conversation.
We're tired of talking.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, and then after this, there is something simply amazing, because when Jesus is hanging on the cross, there is another group of people that we would like to contrast with another person, even though we have only 1 minute before this break. So this group of people is chief priests and the scribes and the elders, and also the centurion. Mm-hmm. And if you can just, in 5 or 10 seconds, tell us what was happening. Who are those priests, scribes, and elders? What do they do when Jesus is hanging on the cross? Sergio? They
openly mock him.
They continue mocking him.
Hey, you're son of God, let yourself down. You're so powerful.
And
where are you now?
All of their questions is, if you are the son of God.
Yeah.
After all of the miracles, you know, it's just absolutely, and the prophecy, and they were supposed to be the people who were, you know, wise and have read the Bible, and they're still mocking him.
Mm-hmm. If you are the son of God. We need to take this short break, but after the break, we will continue our amazing discussion about what it really means and how it brings a perspective to something different and very interesting and fascinating. If you have your computer nearby, now is the perfect time to go online and answer our question, what did Jesus' death on the cross accomplish? We want to hear from you. So text us 707-210-75 and go on Facebook and leave your comment.
Both.
Yes, both. Welcome back. Thank you very much for joining our discussion live, and thank you for your comments and for your texts. And Sergio, let's spend some time and just see what people have to say about our main question and their comments.
Sure, yeah, let's just jump in. Of course, our question is, what was actually accomplished on the cross?
And please continue commenting, and please be part of our discussion.
Yeah, and so James says on Facebook, many things. My salvation, fulfillment of prophecy, defeat of death and Satan, proof of his claims, and above all, the will of God.
Amen. Thank you. Amen.
Thanks, James. Amen. Rachel says, forgiveness for all and eternal life for all who believe. Yeah. Mm. Lauren says, our salvation. Jesus died for our sins so God can forgive us. And I'll jump into the last one as a comment by Melissa. Jithesh was saying over the break how much he's learning. And Melissa says something similar. She says, I'm still blown away by what I just learned on the name of Barabbas and what his name means. That was amazing for me to learn. Thank you.
Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. Praise God.
That's awesome.
Keep on studying with us. And if you want to learn more, just review our last episodes, which is 35 episodes on Cross Connections website.
It's just 35 hours of your life.
35 hours of your, and you can learn with us. And please continue commenting, because this is why we learn together.
And thanks to everyone. These are great comments, really. Please, I'm impressed by every single comment. Yeah.
So we just talked about these schemers who were continuing mocking the Son of God, and they're saying, if you are the Son of God, just come down from
Save
the
yourself.
Cross. If you are the Son of God, where is your God? If they even say that. Where is your God? Let's just see when he comes down. Does it remind you about another story that we studied all the way back in Matthew chapter 4? It was a long time ago. There is another temptation that Jesus faced.
Oh, wow.
When he was 40 days and 40 nights in the desert. And the questions were the same. If you are the Son of God, do what? Make these stones bread.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you are the Son of God, do what? Jump. If you are the Son of God, I will give all everything. Just bow down.
Right.
Here's another question. The last temptations of Jesus.
Sure.
If you are the Son of God, Satan is working.
Yeah.
Wow.
Till the very end, because he feels like the cross is hitting his head.
That's amazing. Because I mean, when I think about, you know, some of the temptations that we go through, you know, with the adversary coming against us, we'll never face the assault and the onslaught that Jesus experienced when he was at his most vulnerable moment. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm sure every last weapon in Satan's arsenal was used on Jesus at that time.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm just going to jump in with a viewer comment, because it's saying right along with what Jennifer said. Uh-huh. It's saying, the death on the cross means everything to me. Without it, I would be doomed forever. During the crucifixion, I believe Satan used all his power to discourage Jesus from going through with the plan of salvation. He's using the same tactics to get Christians discouraged with their faith today.
Absolutely. Amen. But there is a beautiful, a most amazing story, because in the midst of everything that was happening, after Jesus' death already, when there was earthquake, when there was darkness, when Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Yeah? Is this what he say?
Yeah. Yep.
Why have you abandoned me? And he really abandoned him. And if you say, no, it was the time when God was still with him. No. Because even the earth, the presence of God left the earth completely. That's why there was shaking. That's why there was darkness.
It's probably the most painful thing he had to endure. Jesus had to endure.
Not only Jesus, the entire earth, the entire universe was silent. So it was amazing. And after his death, there is one gentleman. Look, let's just read the story. Verse 54. And Jennifer, if you could read for us, could read for us verse 54.
So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God.
Wow.
Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
So after Jesus died,
yeah.
there is billions of people who say, truly,
this is the Son of God.
Yeah. And that is why a lot of them went into amphitheaters when they were eaten by beasts and those wild animals. That's why a lot of them, they didn't mind to be crucified, even head down, because they experienced.
You know, Oleg, when we look through this whole chapter, one thing that is so harsh to me is how very alone Jesus is throughout mm-hmm. this whole thing. His disciples have abandoned him, even denied him. Mm-hmm. One betrayed him. He's going through this suffering all by himself. Even his father has left him, has abandoned him.
This is
alone. And Orchidea on Facebook says something similar. He says, as James in Topeka said, Jesus' death on the cross accomplished my salvation. It is what brings me in connection with God. On the cross, Jesus was alone and took upon himself all our sins. Mm-hmm. I can't begin to imagine how that must have been. He was the atonement for our sins, and because of his death on the cross, we can have eternal life, which Jesus freely gives, if we but believe in him. He did not have to do it, but he chose instead for God's will to be done. It's a simple task we have to do in return compared to the great price that was paid on the cross.
Beautiful.
Amen.
Thank you very much for your comment.
I wanted to add with what Sergio was saying, that God went through, or Jesus went through one of the worst things, just being alone. Mm-hmm. And even sometimes we may feel like we're going through something alone. But one thing I was thinking to in my mind was that at least we can think through it. We think about it and say, you know, maybe I could do this if I do this. But I feel like when Jesus was on the cross, I don't even think that he could think in those ways. Because if he thought it could have happened, you know. I think Jesus was so focused on saving us, on the love that he had for us. He didn't even think about using his power or that calling on the angels to help him or taking himself. He didn't even think it. Can you even imagine not even thinking it when people are constantly telling you if mm-hmm. you are, which you know you are, and if you think it, what would happen? You know what I'm saying? Mm. Jesus didn't even get to that point.
Yeah, this is a very interesting point. And if our viewers have something to add about it, please do. This is fascinating. Mm. And if you look at this story when Jesus was on the cross and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, yeah? Mm-hmm. He actually quoted Psalm 22, mm-hmm. the very beginning of Psalm 22. But nearing the end of the Psalm 22, there is a great reward, great resurrection, great victory. Mm. But at that time, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, there was just darkness.
Yeah.
And we have only 3 minutes left. And Sergio, if you have any other comments, this is the perfect time for
Eunice, who had left a comment before, she just says on Facebook, what a wonderful and inspiring Bible discussion. I have learned so much tonight. Thanks.
Praise God.
Thank you, Eunice, for joining our discussion.
Thank you, Eunice.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah.
Yeah, and continue joining us all the time.
Yeah. Doug says, if Jesus did not die, then he could not show his power over death. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting when he's seemingly so weak and they're mocking him, and really Doug's highlighting his power actually is being displayed on the cross.
Absolutely. And you need to join our discussion next week on Tuesday, because we will continue talking about this victory of Jesus. That is why we are so happy today.
That's right.
Because even going through this suffering, we know that the victory is
right.
Jesus
is
victorious.
Not the end of the story.
Absolutely. So tell Jitesh and Jennifer and Sergio, let me ask you a question that I usually ask. What did you learn today and how it affected your life? We have only, yes, Jennifer, please.
Oh, thank you. I guess so much. I think just a profound feeling that God just loves us so much. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we sort of know it in theory, but when we look at the story of the crucifixion and what Jesus was willing to endure for us, it just, it's amazing. It's very humbling.
Mm-hmm.
For a man who couldn't even think of betraying you or of not fulfilling what he needed to do because he loved you so much, I mean, everyone who's watching should take time to get to know him. Please spend time in the Bible, spend time talking to Jesus, because he sacrificed everything he had, every ounce of what he is for you. So please get to know him.
Amen.
Wow. Wow. Yes. Get to know him. Mm-hmm. And if you want to start, just start reading Matthew chapter 27 and 28. Join us next week and rejoice in the victory of Jesus.
Yeah. You know, what Jennifer said towards the beginning of the program about why there's suffering in the world and all of these things, these tough things that we have to deal with. And you look at this bleak chapter, no one has ever felt more alone than God himself. Mm-hmm. What he went through, none of us have ever felt that type of complete abandonment and being alone. He knows when you're hurting, God is hurting with you. Mm-hmm. He has gone through what you're going through as a human being, mm-hmm. and a million times worse. And it's something that it's really powerful to look through.
Absolutely. Oh, well, it's been a wonderful discussion, and thank you very much for joining us wherever you are, and please continue communicating with us on our Facebook page and our email address. Thank you, Jitesh. Thank you, Jennifer. And we'll be back with you next week, so join us next week, and don't go anywhere because we have a short conclusion as well prepared just for you. The idea of Jesus dying on the cross was utter folly to the natural mind of both Jews and Greeks due to the abhorrence of crucifixion. And the success of the message of a crucified God during Paul's ministry can only be explained by the power of God himself. Today, crucifixion doesn't offend the modern ear as it did in ancient times. More than that, we read and hear about crucifixion without being stirred by the same emotions as those in the early church. It is all too easy to listen to the message of the cross without letting it take root in our lives today. But what does the death of Jesus really mean? To answer this question, we need to go back to the Garden of Eden. After Adam and Eve sinned against God, they hid themselves. But God did not give up on them. He was calling for them. He wanted to unite with them. This is one of God's characteristics. He did not give up on us. He is trying to reunite with us. So perhaps more than anything else, the death of Jesus on the cross proves God's great love for us, for you and me. It is ultimately our assurance of salvation forever. It is the cross that makes us all one with God himself. Jesus on the cross reunites us with God forever if we want to accept his gift. And let the vertical and horizontal beams of the cross remind you of what the union with God is. Vertical beam, because God connects with us, and horizontal, because through Jesus we are in union with each other. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not die, but have everlasting life. Let me encourage you to make this step towards Jesus today, who was willing to be humiliated and die for you and for me on the cross, so that our sins can be forgiven and we can be in close union with the God of the universe. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus Christ in your everyday life and on Cross Connection.